mercy.
You're here.
Your forgiveness.
Forgiveness.
No matter what you've done, no matter how long you've done.
Forgiveness is here.
And your salvation.
Salvation is here.
You're completely saved.
Salvation.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Acceptance.
Come
as you are.
Is here.
Without pretense.
Acceptance.
No need for shame.
Yes.
His grace will. Yes,
deliverance.
Oh, yeah. And his presence.
His presence.
His right hand extended. Pleasures evermore.
His
presence is the fullness of joy.
His mercy.
Hey.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus.
His mercy.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Come on.
Good morning and welcome to Spirit of New Ministries. I'm Pastor Charles Young. Good to have you with us this morning as we come together to lift up the name of the Lord and to celebrate our God who loves us and cares about us. And we are truly glad to be in the house of worship this morning. Join me as we begin our worship by going to the 27th Psalm. And in this 27th Psalm, our reading this morning will be found in the first four verses, Psalm 27, verses 1 through 4. Those in the house with us, if you would stand as we consider that passage of Scripture, I'll be reading from the King James Version. And beginning at verse 1, it reads, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even mine enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell. Though an host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise against me, in this I will be confident. One thing have I desired of the Lord, that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple." Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come today on this glorious Lord's Day to lift up your name. Lord, you are truly worthy of praise, honor, and celebration. We exalt you this morning, Lord, and we magnify your name. And we're thankful that we can worship you in spirit, worship you in truth, and worship you in the collective. So, Lord, allow your spirit to rule and reign here, that all that we would do would be pleasing in your sight, that you would be glorified and your people would be blessed. And for that, we offer our thanks and our praise. It's this prayer that we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen, and God bless you. And again, good morning to each and every one of you. Welcome to the house as we're coming in for the purpose of worship and lifting up the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's good to look out and to see you this morning. And for those of you who are here in the house, if you would kind of just stand and wave to the person that's next to you, give your neighbor a greeting. We know we're not at the point of hugging each other just yet, but you can surely give a wave and a air hug to somebody this morning. It's good to be in the house once again. And as we get ready to continue in our worship, I want to encourage you because in just a little over a week, a very important day is coming up. Our elections are going to be held on November the 3rd, that Tuesday after next. And so please make sure that you're doing everything possible to make sure that your vote will be cast. There is early voting available. You can also cast your ballots via mail. And then also on the 3rd, you can then go to the polling place and cast your vote. This is a very important election, so we encourage everybody, if you can and will, please make a way, make a plan, so that you can go out and cast your vote on Tuesday, November the 3rd. It's time now that we worship God through our giving, our tithes, and our offerings. It's such a good thing to be able to give unto God a portion of what He has blessed us with. And we can do that this morning in several different ways. If you want to give the Spirit of New Ministries, you can go to the Givelify app. You can download that to your device and then follow the prompts. You can also go to the givelify.com website and you can look for Spirit of New Ministries. And there you can also follow the prompts for your giving. And then also you can go to our website, spiritofnewministries.com. And once you were there, go to the donations tab. That will take you to the Givelify tab, and you can again follow the apps for your giving. The Bible says that we ought to bring our tithes to the storehouse, that there would be meat in mine house, herewith saith the Lord of hosts. We do this because God has been so wonderfully good to us, and we want to do the right thing by giving a portion back unto the Lord. So let us now take a moment that we may look to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come this morning with hearts of praise, thanksgiving, and appreciation. We thank you for every blessed gift. We thank you for providing for us. And so, Lord, now we want to be a blessing to others just as you have been a blessing to us. Bless the gifts this morning, the tithes, the offerings, the sacrificial giving. And then, Lord, bless the giver as well. Use these gifts for your kingdom-building purpose. And for that, we give you our thanks. Lord, we ask this prayer in Jesus' name, amen. Again, God bless each and every one of you. It's time now that we go to the Word of God, and those who are here in the house and those who are worshiping with us online, I would ask that you would secure your devices or your hard copy Bibles and join me as we go to the book of Matthew. The gospel as recorded by Matthew, we're going to look at the 4th chapter of Matthew. And there in chapter 4, verses 12 through 17 will be our text for the morning. Matthew chapter 4, verses 12 through 17. And I will be preaching from or reading from the New Living Translation, the NLT version. And as you are securing your devices, I would ask those in the house if you would stand as we honor the Word of God together. Beginning at verse 12, Matthew chapter 4, it reads as follows. When Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he left Judea and returned to Galilee. He went first to Nazareth, then left there and moved to Capernaum beside the Sea of Galilee, in the region of Zebulun and Naphtali. This fulfilled what God said through the prophet Isaiah. In the land of Zebulun and Naphtali, beside the sea beyond the Jordan River, in Galilee, where so many Gentiles lived, the people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And for those who live in the land where death casts its shadow, a light has been shined. From then on, Jesus began to preach, "Repent of your sins and turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is near." You may be seated, those here in the house. And this morning, I want to encourage your hearts from the thought, the gospel Jesus preached. The gospel Jesus preached. When you think about it, the gospel, the good news of salvation, the new life, eternal life by the shed blood of Jesus Christ, his death, burial, resurrection, ascension, and impending return of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Belief in and adherence to the aforementioned truths are necessary for salvation. The doctrinal linchpin and the theological foundation of Judeo-Christian faith and ethic. The core of the great commission of our Lord Jesus, which he declared to his disciples, which can be found in Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20. And there it says, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even until the end of the world. Amen." This is the gospel, the essence. And on three different occasions, in the synoptic gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, our Lord again told his disciples, "And whosoever will not receive you when you go out of that city, shake off very dust from your feet for a testimony against them." This same gospel, the Apostle Paul staunchly and definitively declared that he told the Romans, he said, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek." And then finally, Paul tells his son in the ministry, Timothy, he says, "Be thou not therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me his prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel, according to the power of God." And so this morning, we have in our foundational text, nicely nestled between two critical events, is the Savior of the world declaring the divine truth. First, our Lord Jesus obediently underwent and victoriously overcame the multiple temptations from the devil himself, as chronicled in verses 1 through 11. Then, in verses 18 through 22, Jesus launches his disciple selection campaign, beginning with two sets of brothers, Peter and Andrew, and John and James, also known as the Sons of Thunder, named for their thunderous personalities because they would often bluntly speak their mind without the benefit of a filter. And so now when you consider our passage for the morning and you look at the 12th verse of this fourth chapter of Matthew, what you will find there, it says, "When Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he left Judea and returned to Galilee." This John was none other than Jesus' cousin, John the Baptist, who baptized Jesus in the Jordan River, who prior to his baptism, he acknowledged Christ as Savior in 1 John, or in John chapter 1, verse 29, where he says, "The next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world." You see, John preached a baptism of repentance at the Jordan River and foretold the coming of Jesus as the Messiah. This same John is the same John that was imprisoned and beheaded because he criticized Herod Antipas, the governor of Galilee and Perea, for unlawfully marrying his half-brother's wife, Herodias. And you remember the story. And this was recorded in Matthew 14. It was Herodias who told her daughter Salome, who would ask for John the Baptist's head on a platter. He was then cast into prison and beheaded at Herod's castle. But upon hearing of John's arrest, it says Jesus does something very interesting. He leaves Judea, the area surrounding Jerusalem, and he makes his way first to the region of Nazareth. Verse 13 says he went to Nazareth first, then left there and moved to Capernaum beside the Sea of Galilee in the region of Zebulun and of Naphtali. And beloved, these places had great significance as they related to Jesus' ministry. Nazareth was the place where Jesus grew up, and people knew him there. They were familiar with him. They witnessed how he interacted with his family, with his neighbors, and his community. This was a place of familiarity. And this ministry of Jesus was one of example. You see, our Lord Jesus, he lived a devoted life of righteousness before all who knew him. And truth be told, isn't that how we ought to live? A life of witness, a life of example before the world. For if the world doesn't see Christ's likeness and a godly witness from us, then who are they ever going to see it from? They need to see it from us just as they saw it from our Lord Jesus Christ. And before our Lord ascended from the Mount of Olives, in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, it says, Jesus told his disciples, "But you will receive power when the Holy Ghost comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth." Jesus told them that, and then he goes on to Capernaum, and Capernaum was significant because that's the area where Jesus performed many of his miracles. In Matthew 8 and Luke 7, it's in Capernaum where Jesus had healed the centurion's servant without even seeing him. Jesus healed Peter's mother-in-law in Capernaum, and Jesus also quieted the storm when he said, "Peace be still," on the Sea of Galilee, just off the coast of Capernaum. And in Mark 1, Jesus cast out a demon of a man in Capernaum synagogue. And then Jesus, again, he went to Capernaum because the people there were in darkness and they needed to hear the gospel, much like people are in darkness today, and they need to hear the gospel. They need to hear a word of salvation, encouragement, and everlasting life. And see here, Jesus went to Capernaum because this was a place of darkness. They did not have the gospel. They didn't have the truth the way that the Jews had. And so Jesus went there in order to proclaim life everlasting through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And people need to know that today, in spite of coronavirus, in spite of all of the political wranglings between the parties, in spite of all of the devastation that we're encouraging, right now in 2020, people still need to know that there is a God who sits high, he looks low, and he still saves the lost, and he loves the world, and that's why he gave his only son, Christ Jesus. And we need to tell the world that there is salvation through him and through him alone. And that's why Jesus went to Capernaum, because people needed to hear the gospel. The gospel Jesus preached causes us to go to dark places to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. And the dark places, my friends, are not just geographical locations, but dark places are often spiritual locations where people are depressed and they're downtrodden and they're going through dark seasons in their lives. So the dark places aren't just places on a map, but they're places in the heart, places in the spirit, places in the mind, and places in people's emotion. There's the places where we need to go to declare the gospel of Jesus Christ, that there is hope, and that hope is in Christ Jesus alone. They are often locations where people are not able to get themselves to a place where they can look up and they can see the glory of God, but oftentimes they need a little help. They need to have the gospel that can be that foundation to get them to where they need it to be. And so Jesus, our Lord, the scripture says, he went to Capernaum. But the thing about Capernaum is that because there was no light there, this was a place where even though Jesus went and he did miracles, it was a place where Jesus also criticized. And so you look at Matthew chapter 11, you look at verses 23 and 24, and it says, "And you people of Capernaum," Jesus speaking here, "will you be honored in heaven?" And the answer that Jesus cites is no. "You will go down to the place of the dead. For if miracles I did for you had been done in wicked Sodom, it would still be here today." And you remember the story of Sodom and Gomorrah. It was destroyed because of the rampant sin that rose up in that city. But Jesus said, if the miracles that I did in you were did in Sodom, that place would still be here. And he says in verse 24, "I tell you, even Sodom would be better off on judgment day than you." And that's a horrid accusation that our Lord cast because of the spirit of unbelief. And then when you look at verse 14 here for today, it says, "This fulfilled what God said through the prophet Isaiah, in the land of Zebulun and Naphtali, beside the sea, beyond the Jordan River, in Galilee, where so many Gentiles live." And so many people lived there who had not been a part of the household of the Jews. They were not the chosen people. These were people who were, as verse 16 says, people who sat in darkness. And because they sat in darkness, praise be to God, because of Christ Jesus, because of his love for the world, it says these people were able to see a great light. And these were those who lived in the land of death, where it cast its shadow. And only in the shadow of death were they able to see the light of Christ. And beloved, that's where a lot of people are today. They are living in the shadows of death. They are living in the land of death. And because they're living in the land of death, the only light that they can see is the light of Jesus Christ. And that's our job, to cast that light, that they could see that there is hope and there is strength that comes through Christ and through Christ alone. It's recorded in Isaiah 9 in the first two verses there. It says, "Nevertheless, that time of darkness and despair will not go on forever. The land of Zebulun and Naphtali will be humbled, but there will be a time in the future when Galilee of the Gentiles, which lies along the road that runs between Jordan and the sea, will be filled with glory." And that's good news. That says that even though there's a land of darkness, there will come a time when that land will no longer exist, because the light of Christ will show through the darkness and people will come to know salvation through Christ Jesus alone. It goes on in that second verse of Isaiah 9, it says, "The people who walked in darkness will see a great light." And right now, beloved, we're living in a time of darkness. This has been a year unlike any other. There's so much division, so much chaos, so much sadness, so much death. And I believe that when you look at this passage, it's actually speaking of a time in which we're living right now. And it says that the people who walk in darkness will see a great light. For those who live in the land of deep darkness, a light will shine. Beloved, that's good news. That lets me know that in spite of what we're going through, God provides a light, and that light is Jesus Christ. And we need to understand that the light is not President Trump, the light is not Joe Biden, but the light is Jesus Christ. And I believe that God provided that light in spite of the darkness that we're going through right now. It doesn't matter who ends up in the White House, it's Jesus who's in the lighthouse that provides us with our salvation. And because of that, a light will shine in the darkness. And so it says here, talking about these two areas where the light's not shining, it says Zebulun and Naphtali were two of the 12 tribes of Israel. These were God's chosen people. These were God's children. These were his pride and joy. You see, Gentiles, however, they were not a part of that great tribe of Israel. They were not a part of the Jews. And so they were in darkness because they didn't initially have access to salvation through Jesus Christ. And the good news, the gospel that our Lord Jesus preached, is the gospel that initially, that was first available to, brought to, and preached to the Jews. However, when that gospel was preached to the Jews, the Bible reveals to us that the Jews rejected it. They didn't believe it. They didn't receive it. They didn't embrace it. And therefore, they did not accept it. But praise be to God, because of his love, his mercy, his grace, his kindness, and his compassion, the same gospels that the Jews rejected, the people who were in darkness, it was offered to the Gentiles, and the Gentiles accepted it. Praise be to God. That even though the Jews rejected that gospel, we who are of the Gentile background, we were able to receive it, and the Jews rejected it, but the Gentiles accepted it. And that's why Christ Jesus is the light that shined in the darkness. And that's the gospel that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ preached. That's good news. The fact that even though the gospel was preached to a group of people, they rejected it. God said, I'm not going to stop. I'm not going to end it right here. There's still others that need to have it. So I'm going to give it to the Gentiles. And praise be to God that that salvation that was rejected by the Jews was accepted by the Gentiles. And the Bible says that Jesus Christ is that light. And the Bible reveals that. And you look at John chapter 8. And the 12th verse, it says, Jesus spoke to the people once more and said, I am the light of the world. If you follow me, you won't have to walk in darkness because you will have the light that leads to life. He goes on again in John chapter 12, verse 46. He says, I have come as a light to shine in this dark world, so that all who put their trust in me will no longer remain in the dark. See, you don't have to stay in the dark right now. No matter what you're dealing with, no matter what your circumstances are, you don't have to stay in the dark because the light of Jesus Christ is now shining in the world, and all we have to do is trust him and stand on the boldness of his word. He goes on in Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6, it says, for God who said, let there be light in darkness, has made this light shine in our hearts so that we could know the glory of God that is seen in the face of Jesus Christ. We have that light. That light is not in our government. It's not in our private sector. It's not even in our educational system. But the light that we have is through Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Matthew goes on in the 5th chapter in the 16th verse. It says, in the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father. So what you're talking about here is a transferal of that light. That light that shines through the darkness, we're able to receive. And once we've received that light, we can now declare it. We can show the love of Jesus Christ in our lives in order that those who are still in darkness can see the light of Jesus Christ through our witness and through our example. Look at verse 17. Verse 17 says, from then on, Jesus began to preach, repent of your sins and turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is near. From the White House to the lighthouse, from the rich and the powerful, to the meek and the lowly, as the old preachers used to say, from the uttermost to the guttermost, that message that Jesus preached is relevant to us today in 2020, because even though people are still in darkness, that light is still available. In times such as these, the sin issue, my friends, is still on the table. And one of the many things that I love about my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is that he doesn't spin or sugarcoat a thing. He just keeps it straight 100. He keeps it on point, and he keeps it real. You know how some celebrities, some corporate leaders, especially a lot of our politicians, and we see it a lot of times. We're in a time now where we're seeing a lot of these advertisements on television, and people will say, oh, I really didn't embezzle that money. I just reallocated it to an undisclosed account to enhance our fiscal position in a downward market. No, you stole it. You embezzled it. That's just the bottom line, and we need to stop trying to sugarcoat and stop trying to spin a thing. Or somebody will say, oh, it really wasn't sexual harassment. This was a consensual, mutual collaboration among colleagues, and there's really nothing to report here. No, you were out of order, and you need to realize that that's not acceptable. It's not according to the things of God, and it's not about spinning a thing or trying to make it look right, but wrong is wrong, and right is right. And I'm glad to say that my Jesus, he doesn't spin the truth, but he tells the truth. And we as Christians ought to do likewise. So in the gospel that Jesus preached, he said in John 8 and 32, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth, praise God, shall make you free. The gospel that Jesus preached is confirmed by his word. And when you look through his word, it is replete of opportunities for us to see that his word confirms these principles. For instance, when you look at Romans 3 and 23, it says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That's the gospel. But praise be to God that also in Romans 6:23, he says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Once again, he says in the book of John, in the third chapter, verses 16 through 18, and this is very familiar for the saints. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. That's the gospel. That's the truth of God's word. And then when you go into John, the 14th chapter and the 6th verse, it says, Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. That's just flat out gospel. That's just the truth. He goes on in Ephesians, the 2nd chapter, verses 8 and 9. It says, for by grace ye are saved through faith, and not of your own, not of yourselves, for it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. That's the gospel that says, I can't earn this salvation. I can't work for it. I can't pay for it. I can't buy it. I can't negotiate it, because it's not of works. It's only by grace of our God that gave us Jesus Christ, who went to the cross, who spread his arms, locked his head in his shoulders, and he died, shed his blood, rose from the grave on the third day. That's the only way that we can have salvation. It's not by any works done, but it's by the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And then when you look at Paul and Silas, remember they were in that Philippian jail. And when you look at Acts 16, around the 30th verse, it says, and brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved and thy household. That was told to that guard who thought he was going to lose his life, because when Paul and Silas prayed at that midnight season, the bars of the jails fell down and the door swung open and none of the people left. And so the jailer had to ask the question, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus, and not only you, but also your house will be saved. Again, we're talking about how the word of God confirms this gospel that Jesus preached. When you look at Acts chapter 4 and the 12th verse, it says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Salvation can't happen any other way. We can't wish it. We can't just hope about it, but we have to trust God and confess with our mouths. And that's why Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, that thou shalt believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. See, there's nowhere that you can go to get this salvation. You can't buy it at Walmart. You can't get it at Target. You can't get it any other place but by the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And because of that, the gospel that Jesus preached is that gospel that saves men's souls. It saved them then, it saves us now, and it's going to save him until the day that he returned. We don't know when that time is going to be. The Bible says, no man knoweth when the Son of Man shall return. But until that day, the gospel of Jesus Christ, that light that shines in the darkness, is still available to you and to me. That gospel that Jesus preached is the gospel that saves men and women's souls. That gospel that allows us to belong unto the divine family of our God and allows our names to be written in heaven, and know that when the last trump of God sounds, we'll all be caught up in the air to meet him. And beloved, that is good news. That gospel that Jesus preached is the gospel that still saves souls today. And beloved, if you have not accepted Jesus Christ, if you've not believed on that gospel that Jesus preached, then today, right now, this moment is the opportunity that you have to receive that gospel in Jesus Christ. It's a gospel that says that I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I believe that he died on the cross. And all you have to do right now, if you want to receive that faith that comes by the shedding of the blood of Jesus Christ, this is your time and your opportunity to do that right now. If you want to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and beloved, I encourage you to do it, because we don't know when Jesus is coming back again. And we don't know what's going to happen from one moment to the next. And so we don't want to put our salvation on hold, and we don't want to wait until it is everlasting too late. We need to receive Jesus Christ right now. If you've not done so, then please just bow your heads and repeat this prayer after me. Father, I know that I've sinned. Please forgive me for my sins. I'm ready to turn away from those sins, and I believe in your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for my sins. He was resurrected from the dead, and I invite Jesus to be the Lord of my life right now, to rule and reign in my heart from this day forward. Lord, send your Holy Spirit to help me obey you, trust you from this day forward for the rest of my life. This prayer I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Beloved, I pray that you have taken heed to the message this morning, that you have accepted Jesus Christ. And if so, I would ask that if you're outside of the Louisville area and if you want to join with a local church, please do so immediately. We also welcome you to call us here at Spirit of New Ministries, and you'll see the information on your screen. Certainly, we're welcome to embrace you and to welcome you at Spirit of New Ministries. We want you to have a relationship with Jesus Christ, and in order to help facilitate that relationship, it's good that you would place your life in the hands of somebody who can help guide you, love you, and encourage you in your Christian walk today. Certainly, it was good to have you with us this morning. Remember to join us again on next Sunday at 10:15 right here at Spirit of New Ministries. We certainly look forward to worshiping with you again and having you worship with us. Let us now look to the Lord. We thank God for this day and for all that he has provided. Now may the love of God, the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with us both henceforth now and forevermore. And the children of an all-loving and all-gracious God said amen and amen. And God bless you, and we'll see you next time. All right. God bless you all. God bless you. Good to see you all this morning.